Now to President-elect Joe Biden's public rollout today of the team he wants advising him on the economy. They come with a new agenda that's intended to make a sharp break with the Trump years. Lisa Desjardins reports.
The president-elect slowly made his way into Wilmington's Queen Theater, wearing a walking boot after he fractured his foot playing with his dog over the weekend. But inside, he said he's moving full speed ahead on the nation's economic troubles.
I know times are tough, but I want you to know that help is on the way.
At the tables around him, President-elect Joe Biden's key economic team, and a theme repeated by each one, to not just regain a full economy, but to tackle inequality and make it more fair.
We can build a new American economy that works for all Americans, not just some, all. We need to act now, though.
It's a team of policy heavyweights. Former Federal Reserve Chair Janet Yellen to serve as Treasury Secretary. Neera Tanden, the president and CEO of the Center for American Progress, a liberal think tank, to lead the Office of Management and Budget. And labor economist Cecilia Rouse to chair the President's Council of Economic Advisors. Yellen spoke first.
We will be an institution that wakes up every morning thinking about you. Your jobs, your paychecks, your struggles, your hopes, your dignity, and your limitless potential.
If confirmed, Neera Tanden would be the first woman of color to be the OMB director. She reflected on being raised by a single mother, an immigrant from India.
I'm here today because of social programs, because of budgetary choices.
But Tanden's become a lightning rod for some Republicans, like Arkansas Senator Tom Cotton, who say she's been a partisan, divisive figure.
I think Neera Tanden's nomination, like so many of the nominations that Joe Biden's already made, show that he is not committed to unifying the country.
Princeton Dean Rouse would be the first African-American to lead the Council of Economic Advisors.
This is a moment of urgency and opportunity, unlike any we face in modern times.
Among the other Biden selections, Nigerian-born attorney and political advisor Wale Adeyemo, who worked with Biden when he was vice president, will serve as deputy treasury secretary. Longtime Biden advisor Jared Bernstein would serve on the Council of Economic Advisors alongside economist Heather Boucher, the president, CEO, and co-founder of the Washington Center for Equitable Growth. As Team Biden moves toward governing, President Trump continues to fight. Suing in Wisconsin to try and throw out 221,000 ballots in two heavily Democratic counties. He repeated baseless claims of voter fraud. This the same day as Attorney General William Barr said there is no evidence to support those claims.
And Lisa joins me now from Wilmington, Delaware, while Yamiche Alcindor is here in Washington. Hello to both of you. So Lisa, picking up on that, now that we've seen the economic team that Joe Biden wants advising him, what does that tell us about what they want to do now and once they're in office?
Well, this is a team that faces unprecedented double crises and rarely a new president taking over with them at the same time. However, this team is also unique in that the president who is elected, who will be their leader, has had many plans in the works for a long time. Right off the bat, we know this team, Judy, is working on a larger planned, bigger stimulus, bigger COVID relief coming next year, in addition to what they hope will be perhaps some relief coming in the next few months. And I think we see in this team some of the hints of how they hope to get this done. And I think what we'll see from more Biden announcements, this is a team of experienced people. They are diverse, and they are known for doing the hard work of policy. Also, what I noticed today, they are disciplined and very coordinated, right down to the masks, each one of them wearing the exact same mask that was handed out to them beforehand. And they're also coordinated in another goal, trying to not just respond to the economic crisis, but to try and solve more than one problem at once. Listen to the coordination on these talking points. We heard from Yellen. She's concerned about the disproportionate impact of the crisis. From Tanden, she wants a fair shot for American workers. From Adeyemo, he wants to reduce inequality. Biden is being very aggressive here in signaling that he is concerned about inequality in America. He wants whatever plan they come up with to address the crisis to squarely tackle inequality and also perhaps climate change, as I'm told by some who are working with him, that that's something we could also see as part of their plan. One other thing, Judy, that they have to contend with, of course, is Congress and whether or not any immediate relief will come out. As you reported earlier, this is a tricky situation for a new president. Doesn't want to spend any capital before he comes into office, but they also would like to have some kind of stimulus moving now. I want to also add, Speaker Pelosi sent out a statement late today saying, interestingly enough, that she says there must be some COVID relief passed in this lame duck session of Congress. That's the next 2 weeks. So we see both sides at least acknowledging they need to do something. Whether they will is a different question.
We've heard it before. We'll see if it's real this time. Lisa, thank you. And Yamiche, to you, as we reported earlier, the Attorney General, Bill Barr, said today in an interview, the Department of Justice has found no widespread evidence of fraud that would change the outcome of the election. How is the president, how is his campaign responding to this?
Well, Attorney General William Barr has really angered the president's campaign, as well as allies of President Trump, simply by telling the truth, and that truth being that the election was not full of any sort of voter fraud that would have tipped the scales and changed the outcome, thus lending credibility to the fact that President-elect Joe Biden is, in fact, the projected winner and President Trump is, in fact, the projected loser. I've been talking to people that are close to the president all day about this. They say that they think Attorney General William Barr is, quote, someone who is a total failure. They also said that this was a complete betrayal on his part, talking to the Associated Press. In that interview, William Barr told the Associated Press that some see the Department of Justice as a sort of fix-it-all. In there, he was essentially hinting at the fact that there are people who want to look at the courts and the criminal justice system and say, you overturn this election for President Trump, you try to do something. And Attorney General William Barr is making it very clear that he's not going to do that. Another thing to note is that as all this is going on, the rhetoric is really getting more and more tense from the Trump campaign. We heard yesterday a Trump campaign lawyer suggest that Christopher Krebs, the former U.S. head of election security that President Trump fired, that he should be shot, Judy. He said those words, and now Christopher Krebs is saying that he's looking at legal action. All this is happening as a Republican official in Georgia tonight is saying someone is going to get killed. We need you, President Trump, to really lower down this rhetoric, calling out to the president. The president has not done that as of yet. Another thing to note, as all of this is happening, the president has continued to fundraise for this election defense fund. He's raised at least $150 million, we're told by sources. So as the president is dealing with all of this, he's continuing to get supporters to give him money for what is really now a long shot bid to try to win back the election in some way.
So disturbing, those reports about the potential for threats and for loss of life. Really disturbing. Yamiche Alcindor, Lisa Desjardins, we thank you both.